thank you very much for the introduction. And also thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I think it's the first time that I'm in a meeting where I don't know anyone. So, and for that, yeah, I didn't know, but I'm learning to know people more and more. And so for those that still stay till the end, I quickly want to say where Leuven is. So Leuven is a university town close to the capital of Belgium, to Brussels. Brussels has not really a big university, so the biggest university of Belgium is in Leuven. I'm not from Ghent, like is indicated on my name tag. Ghent is somewhere here, so it's closer to the seaside. And so now we are sitting somewhere here. This is France. So you should know Leuven, or at least that's what I hope you should learn to know Leuven from the historical things. There's a lot to see in Leuven, so whenever you're in Belgium, just give me a call or an email, so I will guide you around. It's a very old university. It's one of the oldest universities on the continent. And if you don't know Leuven from the research or from the students, you should know Leuven from the beer. So Stella Artois is from Leuven. And the combination beer and students is apparently a perfect combination. Okay, so that's the introduction. What I want to show you today is what aging is doing to our population. So especially the Western population is becoming older and older. It's also increasing, the number of people is increasing. And what you see here in the red dashed line is the number or the percentage of people over 60 that we will have over time. And you see that more than 20% of the population in 2050 will be over 60. So older people also means that there is much more neurodegeneration. And neurodegeneration will come with a cost. And so what is this? What is shown here is a simulation of what it will cost to the society if we all become older. And if we all start to suffer from neurodegenerative disorders. There is no cure for any of these disorders. And one of the reasons that there is no cure is because of an insufficient understanding of the pathogenic mechanism of the etiology and the pathogenesis of these diseases. And that's why I think we need to do a lot of research on these diseases. This is a slide showing what happens in a number of these neurodegenerative disorders. They are different in the sense that they affect different regions of the brain. They're also different in the aggregates that are formed in these different regions. And today I would like to focus on one of these neurodegenerative disorders. It's called ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. And that's the disease that we are studying in the lab. What is ALS? ALS is a motor neuron disease. It affects selectively motor neurons. And we have two types of motor neurons. We have the motor neurons that are in the motor cortex, are the higher motor neurons. And these higher motor neurons, they connect with the lower motor neurons. And the lower motor neurons are in the brainstem and in the ventral horn of the spinal cord. These lower motor neurons, they connect, the ones that are in the brainstem, they connect to the facial muscles and the muscles that you need for swallowing. And the lower motor neurons, they go to your arms and to your feet, legs and feet. And so, yeah, that are the ones you need for voluntary movements. But also the ones that you have here, you need them to talk. So what happens if these motor neurons start to degenerate? You cannot move around anymore and you cannot talk anymore. So, which means you're in some kind of a locked-in state. So you cannot communicate anymore with your environment. The consequences of this dramatic disease, well, it's a very dramatic disease because you die from the disease usually 2 to 5 years after the detection of the first symptoms.
How common is this?
It's a rare disease. Having said that, at this moment, there are 4 to 5 million people running around on the world that will die from ALS.
It's lethal.
So it's lethal. So the incidence, just to give you another number, the incidence is the same as the incidence of multiple sclerosis, which is a disease that is much better known. There are also many more MS patients running around, but that's because they don't die from the disease. So it's an incidence between 2 to 4 per 100,000 per year. So what are the first symptoms? First symptoms are benign, so spasticity and hyperreflexia, atrophy of skeletal muscles, and then, as I already said, loss of speech, and also people get paralyzed. And there is no cure, so it's a dramatic disease without a cure. What is also important to know is that in 10% of cases, it is an inherited disease. So in 10% of cases, there are more family members that suffer or have suffered from the same disease, which means in 90% of diseases, we have no clue what the cause is. So that's an open question. So in these 10% of familial patients, we know in almost 80% of cases what the underlying genetic cause is. And I've here indicated the most important ones. I will come back to these genetic causes in a minute. What I also would like to point out is that what the pathology of this disease is, I told you in the beginning that every disease has typical aggregates, every neurodegenerative disease has typical aggregates. In the case of ALS, 95% of patients have mislocalized TDB43, which aggregates. So it's mislocalized in the cytoplasm. Normally, TDP43 is a nuclear protein, but in the disease cases, TDP43 is mislocalized in the cytoplasm, and in the other cases, it's SOD1 or FUS. So, okay. So what is our goal is to understand the initial steps of the disease. And the major question we would like to answer is, how do these mutations that we know, how do they result in the pathology? And one of the things that I've just indicated is that mislocalization of that protein called TDP43. Yeah, it's an RNA-DNA binding protein. So it has a role in RNA transport, in DNA damage, rescue against DNA damage. So it's quite well known what it's doing. It's less well known.
Globular protein.
Sorry?
Globular.
Well, it's unstructured.
Structured.
Yes. So it has low complexity domains. And I will come back to that later during my talk, because that's important. We hope that by studying the underlying mechanism that we can find also therapeutic targets. What I also would like to indicate that is that there is a lot of variability in a family, for instance, with the same mutation. And the example I've taken now is mutation in another gene, superoxide dismutase 1. It's the enzyme that we all need to get rid of our free radicals to downregulate oxidative stress. That's a genetic cause that is already known for a long time, more than 20 years. And so we have in Belgium patients with the mutation in SOD1. And you can see that the disease duration varies from 2 years to 20 years. So patients belonging to the same family have a difference in disease duration that is so significant and so dramatic. And there again, what we want to know is, why is that? So which factors, which modifiers are responsible for that major difference? And again, if we know these modifiers, we can also try to develop therapeutic targets against these modifiers. By the way, there are exceptions on the rule that patients die after 2 to 4 years. And you all know one person, Stephen Hawking, has ALS, but he has an atypical form of ALS. He has already disease for 30 years, so he stabilized in a far advanced stage. Nobody knows why.
But nobody knows the mutation. What he
has. No. He has a sporadic form, but that doesn't matter. So there are also in the sporadic forms, there is also a lot of variation.
The sequence was done.
Yeah. He has not a genetic cause of ALS, like in 90% of cases. Stephen Hawking also illustrates another aspect of the disease. Cognitively, these patients are still okay. So only the motor system fails. Only the motor Only the motor neurons die, sorry. So that's just to illustrate that there is a lot of variation in the disease. I want to come back to one of the causes, one of the genetic causes of ALS, and it's a very special one. We have already heard about repeats in genes when there was a talk about Fragile X. There is also a gene causing ALS that also contains repeats in a non-coding sequence, also in a non-coding sequence. It's C9orf72. Why is it called C9orf72? It's located on chromosome 9. It's an open reading frame, and it's got number 72. So nobody really knows what the gene product of this open reading frame, what it actually is. The repeat is a hexanucleotide repeat. 4 G's, 2 C's, so G, 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 C, C. Normally, well, I hope that we all have 2 to 8, maximum 8 of these repeats. In patients, you have 100 and several thousands of this repeat. And it's located, like I said, it's located in a non-coding region.
If you will develop disease, if mutation happens.
Yeah, when you have such a large expansion of that hexanucleotide repeat, you will get a disease. The only thing you don't know is when.
No, but already have it before we started, have it been checked before they had developed disease.
Yeah. You can do that now, because now we know what the cause of the disease is. Now, indeed, we have pre-symptomatic carriers. Mm-hmm. We have families where we know that there are patients that have the repeat and that will get, sooner or later, the disease. It's important because now we can even look much earlier what is going wrong in these patients. Well, we should not call them patients. At that moment, they are not yet sick. Eh? So the big discussion in the field now, and well, I think most of people working in ALS are shifting to the hexanucleotide repeats in C9orf72, is how do these hexanucleotide repeats, how do they cause ALS? And there are different possibilities. I will come back to that in a minute, but there is another thing I have to tell you, and that is that these repeats are translated. They are translated in a non-ATG mediated fashion. So there is no ATG in the in this repeat, in this intron, but despite that, they are translated, and not only the sense RNA is formed, also the antisense RNA is formed. And so because it's a hexanucleotide repeat, and because there is no ATG, they can be translated in every reading frame. So theoretically, that means that there are 6 potential dipeptide repeat proteins. But because there is one in the sense, the GP is translated both from the sense and from the antisense strand. So we have 5 different dipeptide repeat proteins that can be translated from this repeat in a non-ATG mediated fashion.
Do you know which is the polymerase?
No, there's not much known about that. They are now investigating how it actually works. Well, in the beginning there was even a discussion, does this happen in the nucleus or in the cytoplasm?
It's a lot of investigation.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. And so is it cap dependent or cap independent?
They know mechanisms now. They know, but it's still not published.
That's not what we are doing actually. So, but indeed, it is important to know how this works because it's also happening in other repeat diseases. Also in Huntington, there are also repeats, and they are also translated. And the translation seems to be upregulated under stress. So cells under stress, they increase this non-ATG mediated RAN translation, is it called?
Okay, large amounts are made.
Well, you can detect it in the CSF and in the blood. You can also find them back in pathological material. It's not really known how much of these proteins you have. The concentrations, vary. There's also not a very good correlation between the place, for instance, where they find these aggregates and where you have the motor neuron dead. So there is some kind of a discrepancy there. So there are still a lot of open questions, but these repeats were only discovered 6 years ago, 5-6 years ago. So it's relatively recent. So
what's the tissue specificity of this?
It's present in every tissue. Well, you mean the DPR production? Yeah, it's mainly in neuronal cells that you can find them, but also in astrocytes. So it's, but not in, as far as I know, not outside of the CNS.
But there are a lot of things that basically are appearing.
Yes.
At the onset or associated with the ALS, right? But that's happening late in.
This happened, well, that's of course a problem. You can only, well, you can see it in the CSF and in the blood already at disease onset. Mm-hmm. And that's why these people that have the repeat, but that are not yet sick, why they are so interesting. But the fact is that most of them are still not sick. I mean, but in like say 5, 10, 15 years, some of them will develop the disease. And well, we are following them now already, so we will see when, for instance, these DPRs show up, which was previously only possible in patients when they were already sick, or when you have to look, well, postmortem material, yeah, that will always be the same. It's at the end of life, so that's that doesn't make much of a difference. But in for biomarker research, you can now go much earlier to detect what shows up. So we focused on the DPRs, that's why I introduced them so extensively. Before I go on focusing on these DPRs, I would like to give a little bit of a broader picture in the sense that it's still not yet known whether it is due to loss of function or due to gain of function that these repeats cause ALS. Although there are a lot of arguments that it's not just loss of function. I'm not saying that loss of function couldn't play a role, but it doesn't seem to play a major role. So the expression of C9orf72, for instance, seems to be quite similar in patients and in controls. And then there are two gain of function mechanisms proposed. There are RNA foci seen in the nucleus, and these RNA foci, they contain these repeats, these hexanucleotide repeats, and they also bind RNA binding proteins. And so maybe by doing that, they deplete the nucleus from some essential RNA binding proteins. So that could be a gain of function. And then the other gain of function is what I just described, is that RAN translation, the production of these DPRs that you usually don't have and that can become toxic. What have we done when these repeats were discovered and when DPR translation was suggested as being important? We have made constructs where we have introduced an ATG in front of a sequence, and we used the wobble positions to create a coding sequence that doesn't contain the repeats. And these constructs also, they only express one of the DPRs, because that's the problem when you just express, for instance, these repeat RNAs in cells. Yeah, you don't know what actually is translated from them. So you will have a mixture of all of them. So what we have now is constructs with just one of the DPRs expressed. And these constructs don't form RNA aggregates, for instance. Okay, so we use these constructs to find out which mechanisms are responsible for DPR-induced motor neuron death. And the story I would like to share with you, or the first story I would like to share with you, is the role of nucleocytoplasmic transport that we discovered a few years ago. This was done both in yeast and in flies. And so in yeast, you have an inducible system, so you can turn on the expression of the different DPRs. And so then you have a dilution test. So you dilute and you see how many of the yeast colonies survive. When you turn on the expression of the arginine containing, the GR and the PR, then you can see, well, for instance, for the PR here, that there are no yeast cells growing. And also for GR, you can see that that the number of yeast that is growing, the number of colonies, is lower. While the other two that are tested here don't have an effect on survival. We did similar things in the fly eye. And so here is a control eye. It looks like a control eye, but in fact, it expresses one of the DPRs, PA, and it doesn't show any defect. While when we express again an arginine containing DPR, you can see that the eye looks a bit sick. It's not only the eye that is affected when we just express, because in that case we only express the DPRs in the fly eye. We can also express the DPRs in the motor neurons or in the whole body. And what you see then is that the ones that again express the arginine-containing DPRs, that they have a shorter survival, whether these are females or males, it doesn't make a difference. And now that we have this system where we have clearly cell death that is induced by certain types of DPRs, we can use that system to look for modifiers.
Why is the arginine like it?
Sorry?
Why the arginine contain?
That's a good question.
If you replace it with lysine, will it do the same thing?
No, the arginine is important. So, but again, I will try to give an answer. I'm not saying I know the answer, but we have some hints what could be.
Before a question, this repeats that for all patients are only having this in the family. This repeats even for.
It's only for the ones that have the hexanucleotide repeats in C9orf72.
All patients with disease have this repeat.
Yes. If you have the repeat, you have the DPRs.
If you have this disease, do you have necessarily repeat?
No. No. Because. Yeah. So only 10% is familial. Okay. And from the 10% that is familial, 60% have the repeats that I just described.
The rest have no repeat. They may have developed disease without repeat.
Yeah, the rest have or other mutations in other genes, or mutations in genes that we don't know. But the majority, and that's important to know.
Mutation of the same protein.
Sorry?
Misfolding of the same protein.
Well, in the end, it's always TDB43. That is found, and that is independent of whether it's genetic or sporadic. That's very important to mention indeed. So the pathogenic end result is always the same, independent of whether you have the repeat or whether you have no genetic cause or whatsoever. So that's indeed an interesting observation, and to be honest, we don't really know why that is. And I will come back to that also in the end. So, now we have two models, yeast and fly, and we can use these models to screen for modifiers. So, for instance, for the fly, we just have siRNA expressing flies. For the yeast, you have deficiency strains, and you just mate them, you just cross them, and then you can see whether this improves the condition of the yeast or whether it improves the eye of the fly, whether it has no effect at all or whether it makes it worse. So that's a classical modifier screen that you can do in these organisms, and they have the advantage that all these lines are available, so it's relatively easy to do these screens. And so this is just an illustration what it means to be better or worse. So this is the control condition where we just express the arginine containing DPR. Here is a modifier that makes it worse. Here is a modifier that makes it better. The same for the fly eye. This is what we normally see with some pigmented places in the eye. Here the pigmentation is much more pronounced, so this modifier makes it worse. Here you can see that it almost looks like the healthy eye, so this is a modifier that makes it better. Okay, so which modifiers did we find? And that's illustrated here. The modifiers that had the biggest effect had to do with or the nuclear pore or the nucleocytoplasmic transport. And so these are a number of enhancers that all have to do with nucleocytoplasmic transport. Here are a number of suppressors that have to do also with nucleocytoplasmic transport. And also in the yeast screen, these modifiers were overrepresented. So the genes that have a role in nucleocytoplasmic transport were overrepresented in the modifiers, both in the enhancers and in the suppressors, which makes it more complex, of course. And so if I summarize a lot of work in one slide, so this is a representation of all the enhancers and all the suppressors that we have found both in flies and yeast. And in red, it are the enhancers, and it are mainly the constituents of the nucleocytoplasmic transport mechanism that are in the cytoplasm, while the suppressors are mainly localized in the nuclear pore. But don't ask me how they influence toxicity. That's something we are investigating now. It plays a role. The only thing we don't know is which role. I mean, that's more complicated to find out than we expected.
So, in the protein import, you have the mTOR. Which mTOR is this?
That I don't know by heart. I should.
It's like RUN GTP. What is it? But there is another mTOR. I don't know.
Nobody
knows.
Yeah, it's in the I don't know, but I should check which one it is. So I don't know all the. I'm still learning how.
The same name to many proteins.
Yeah, and these are, to make it even more complicated, these are the names of the fly genes. Yeah, so I'm not sure whether it's the same mTOR. No, I don't think so. So these are the fly names. So I can check which what it is in.
Basically, you're getting anything that is affecting the nuclear pore.
Yeah. And it's doing it in both directions. It would be nice if it was always preventing toxicity, but that's not the case. And that's, we are not the only ones, by the way, that found this. So other groups have similar problems, so to say. But it's always clear, because there are two other groups that came up with similar data, it's always clear that it's that it has to do with nucleocytoplasmic transport. So that's the interesting thing, let's say.
So did you look to see if there is any direction here, directionality here?
That's something we are investigating now. So we are now
because the enhancer versus suppressor could be explained by who helps to go to one way.
Yeah. Well, the first thing we thought was maybe the DPRs are just binding to the nuclear pore. Right. It doesn't seem to be that simple. I mean, that's not no. That's I mean that had been too easy, I suppose. So
could it be that this particular, I mean, it's actually the RNA that is then
No, in this case.
No, it's bound to a particular protein that's moving it up. I mean, because it's so rich in the.
All options are open. So because of course, it's RNA both as proteins that have to pass. The pore.
So but it is translated, so it means that
you have no idea at this point whether the effect was in the RNA or is the effect in the protein.
The possibility that the RNA is stuck in the pore.
So how is it translated?
It could be other RNA. It could be other RNA that is. It doesn't need to be the repeat RNA. That's what you, I think, are referring to. Wasn't there a question? Okay.
Well, my point was the very one what the hexanucleotide repeat was recoded, so the repeat is no longer.
No. In this case, the repeat is not there. So in the models that we have, there is clearly no effect of repeat RNA. But of course, in the patients, we don't know. So it's and of course, it could also just be other RNAs. That's the point I just wanted to make. Okay, so that's nucleocytoplasmic transport. We made some nice movies. That's these days. What we think is happening, and so you have to think about the orange dots as being TDP43. When something is going wrong with nucleocytoplasmic transport, it could very well be that they mislocalize in the cytoplasm, so that in one way or another. But again, this is an oversimplified model because we have no clue how it exactly works. If I then just go to what happens with TDP, so normally TDP is localized in the nucleus. What we see happening over time is that TDP43 gets mislocalized, not only in the patients that have the hexanucleotide repeat. So this happens in all the patients.
If you would express this in a mammalian cell, do you get also this localization through cell division? In other words,
I'm trying to figure out whether we don't see mislocalization of TDP43 in simplified cell system. Yeah. So we also have, and I will come back to that in later. We have, for instance, now iPSC lines that we can differentiate into all kinds of cells. We don't see in these cell systems, we don't see the same mislocalization of what you see in the patients. But of course, these patients, when they become sick, they're 50, 60, 70 years old.
In the flies,
we also don't see mislocalization.
So how do you explain that? How do we connect?
We don't know. That's the honest answer.
fuzz is also mislocal.
Yeah, fuzz is also mislocal. I could more or less tell the same story with fuzz instead of TDP-43, but fuzz is much more rare. That's only in 2 to 3% of patients.
In which cells did you do that, the mislocalization?
The mislocalization is in the patient. So the mislocalization is a post-mortem material, but of course you start from what you see in patients, so it's mislocalized. Okay. So the question is, what's the explanation for that? The explanation of that could be that there is a problem with nucleocytoplasmic transport. That's the point I just want to make with these movies.
In the patient, you're integrating after many years. This is not the same as in your culture condition.
Of course not. I mean, that's exactly the point I want to make. I mean,
so it might not be anything to do with traffic, huh?
But it could be. And it modifies. It can modify the nucleocytoplasmic transport.
It
is DPR. Yes, and in yeast. No.
You can generate cell line from the patient. And
yeah.
All the nuclear pore proteins that were induced, yeah. And yes. See if it will reverse it.
That's indeed what people are now doing. That is whole genome CRISPR-Cas9 screens on iPSC lines or on motor neurons that are differentiated from. And there was, I think, yesterday or the day before yesterday, there was a paper in Nature Genetics where they have done a DPR screen. It's a group from Stanford where they have done a DPR screen on cell lines. Mm-hmm. And they found again that the nucleocytoplasmic transport was overrepresented in the hits they had. Together with, for instance, ER stress was also there. DNA damage-related proteins were there. So it was not only nucleocytoplasmic transport. And of course, the next question is, what in a neuronal system? Because this was not yet in a neuronal system.
Any idea what's special in motor neurons? So what particular?
They have very long axons. And they have also another way of signaling. So in the glutamatergic signaling, they don't use NMDA receptors. They are more dependent on AMPA receptors. And there are, less calcium binding proteins. I mean, there is a lot of things that are different in motor neurons in comparison to other neurons. Whether that's all related to the disease, that's of course another question.
Is it known that these aggregates are actually the cause of the neurological symptoms?
No. And that's of course, that's also an argument I sometimes use when I have to answer the question, how do you explain the fact that the aggregates don't correlate, the aggregates of the DPRs don't correlate with the cells that die in the disease? Maybe it's just a way of the cell to get rid of something that is very dangerous.
Yeah.
It's possible.
Yeah, it's possible.
Could it be that due to the long axon, mm-hmm. and that the protein need to travel a long time in order to get to the nucleus?
To get translated.
No, they are getting translated cytoplasm, but then they have to travel.
Yeah. Yes,
for
and
a long time.
That's indeed a good point, because one of the roles of TDP-43 is to bring RNA to the neuromuscular junction.
Okay.
So in that sense, but then of course, then it has to go back and to go back to the nucleus to get the next RNA. So that axonal transport is important. That seems to be. And I will come back to that if I still have time.
Is all mechanism this particular transport, how it being achieved, what is the mechanism?
The mechanism of what?
Who is this transport? What are proteins which move it?
The normal motor proteins, dynectin, kinesins, the normal, and I will come back to that in the end of my talk, hopefully.
The DNA damage proteins you spoke about, are they known?
Yeah, they are known, but not by me.
Have they something to do with slippery or with repeats?
No. I think, as far as I remember, it's single-strand DNA breaks and double-strand. I can try to.
Nothing to do with the repeats.
No. Most like no. It's just apparently there.
How do you generate the repeats?
Sorry.
How do you generate the repeats?
In which case?
With what you showed. There.
Yeah, that's all overexpression. That's also something you have to keep in mind. Yeah. Everything I showed until now is overexpression of a construct with a repeat.
What you showed in some cases, there are repeats, hexam, as in other. So is it known what is the kinesis, how the mechanistic kinesis.
The
question of some the machinery of DNA.
Yeah. Replication.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. No, that's you not. No. It's not even known. Okay. It's not even known whether the length is the same in every tissue. So it could even be that, for instance, in neurons you have much longer repeats than in other tissue.
But it's 25. It's easier to verify with modern techniques. Yeah.
That's what people are doing for the moment. Yeah, it's trying to figure out. Right. And it's also not that the next generation always has longer repeats than the previous ones. But there is variation. There is clearly variation. But the last word has not been said. I mean, this is relatively recent, like I said. So it's work in progress. To end this part of nucleocytoplasmic transport, it seems to be a key pathway, and that's confirmed now again with also the whole genome CRISPR-Cas9 screen that I just mentioned, and that is published, I think, the day before yesterday. What we are investigating for the moment is what the exact mechanism is. So that's still an open question. But while we were doing these experiments, we purified the DPRs, and we had pure DPR protein. And when we looked at it in a test tube, then we noticed that these test tubes could become opaque. For instance, when we cooled them down, when we just put them on ice, then we could see that something like this happens. So normally this solution is transparent. If you cool it down or if you add a molecular crowder, it gets opaque. And so what you then see under the microscope is that droplets are formed. So that was not known until we observed that just by accident. So these are droplets of the arginine-containing DPRs. So when we just have arginine-containing DPRs in the right conditions, then we can just see that they form these kind of droplets, that they phase separate. That's actually what happens. And so that's actually the same as what happens with oil and vinegar. So you have phase separation, so there is no membrane around it. So these proteins seem to cluster together. And what is now a very popular view in the field, and that brings me back to the formation of the aggregates, is that you have these physiological granules, which are these droplets, that are not only formed by DPRs, but also, for instance, TDP43, which is also a protein with low complexity domains, but also FUS, for instance, that they form these physiological aggregates, sometimes in combination with RNA, but I will come back to that in a minute. And that then over years, this can result in pathological aggregates because this process is reversible. So going from soluble to physiological granules is a reversible process. Similar with here, if we just warm this solution, then these droplets disappear. And we can do that 100 times. There are no aggregates formed in our test tube, but maybe in the cell, under certain conditions, you can have the formation of these physiological granules, these droplets, and then over time they can form pathological aggregates. I already told you, but it's a characteristic only, again, of the arginine-containing DPRs. So when there is no arginine in the DPR, you don't see it. Yeah, here's what you see under.
The only arginine-containing even the repeats, or arginine-containing. It's common for all DPRs.
No, it's only for the arginine-containing DPRs. So you need to have, it's PR or GR. So, and you also need to have the right buffer conditions because the problem, of course, is you have a lot of positive charges. So you need to have counter ions. So, and in the case, you have to have the right buffer. So it works best with a phosphate buffer. So that's what you see here. For instance, in potassium chloride, you don't see them. And that's why also a lot of people missed this formation of these droplets. And what is also important to indicate is that RNA can also, can also be a counter ion, so the negative charges of RNA. And so when you, for instance, what you see here is increasing concentrations of RNA added to a solution of the arginine-containing DPRs. So the higher the concentration of RNA, the more turbidity we see, the more droplet formation we see. Okay, we can also do FRAP, so we can bleach fluorescence recovery after bleaching. So we bleach, and then you can see that the fluorescence, if we label the arginine-containing DPRs fluorescently, you can see that the fluorescence come back. So it's a dynamic process, and here you can see it over time. We have young and old droplets. It doesn't make much of a difference. So it's not that we have aggregate formation in our test tubes, because these are test tube experiments. So then what we did was we did mass spec on the proteins that associated with these arginine-containing DPRs. So a little bit to our surprise, when we centrifuged a solution with arginine-containing DPRs, we found that there were a lot of proteins bound to these DPRs. And then if we did mass spec, the most prominent pathway that popped up was were the stress granules. And stress granules are also structures that are formed by phase separation. So there are also no membranes around the stress granules. And so then we started to look at stress granules. So this is a cell line where the GGPB1 is labeled, is fluorescently labeled. And then if you put these cells under stress, then you can see that droplets are formed in the cell. And you can even see, if you focus here in this region of the cell, you can see that they also start to form bigger droplets, that they fuse a little bit the same as the droplets that I've just shown you in the test tube. But the difference is that these are stress granules in a cell, where also RNA is included in these stress granules, while what I've shown before.
Don't form the liquid droplets, right? You cannot see the opaque.
No. Yeah, this is a cell. I mean, you have to label them with.
When you take them out.
What taking the stress granule?
Yeah, if you
feel like stress granule has nothing to do with the oil, like.
Yeah, well, it's a similar process. The formation of a stress granule is the same thing as what you see when the olive oil is separating from the vinegar. So it's a similar process, of course. I mean, here is also RNA involved, which is not the case when you are looking at your cell up dressing.
So you inhibit translation. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah. And I think G3BP1 is indeed a protein that binds to RNA to prevent it from being translated, because indeed these stress granules.
Okay, what are these stress granules? What they are?
Yeah, stress granules is a way of the cell to keep RNA shielded and untranslated for a while the cell is taking care of surviving. So it's upregulated proteins that keep it alive. And the other RNA that at that moment is less important is just stalled away in the stress granules.
And they're surrounded by proteins?
No, this is a combination of proteins and RNA. Okay. So this what you see here is a blob of proteins and RNA combined. And
how big are these granules? How big are they?
Very small. So this is the cell. So this is very small. It's very small granules.
But you can see them with fluorescent microscope.
Yeah, this is fluorescent microscope.
So it's about 5 millimeters or something?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, I mean. Large? Well, you can have them in different sizes, but they are subcellular. So
what is this response to? What is stress?
Yeah, stress can be everything. So in this case, what you see here is arsenite. That's a very popular way of putting cells under stress, but it can also be oxidative stress. It can also be heat. I mean, whatever you can do to a cell that puts them under stress will lead to the formation of these stress granules. And once the stress is gone, these stress granules disassemble. So then the cell starts to use the RNA again. I mean, then that's at least what should happen.
It's probably to preserve ATP in part, because mRNA translation is the major consumer of ATP.
Oh, as well, yeah. So, but in a way, it's just to protect the cell from stress. It's a stress response. And the point I want to make is that, you can do it by arsenite, so by addition of arsenite, but you can also do it, you can induce these stress granules also by adding the arginine-containing DPRs. So that's also apparently a stress. It also induces stress granules. And what is also indicated here is that in the case that you induce the stress by these DPRs, you have more TDP43 in the stress granule, if you compare it to stress granules that are induced by arsenite. So that's the my second conclusion. So the arginine-containing residues, they are, well, the arginine-containing DPRs, they undergo liquid-liquid phase separations. These arginine-containing DPRs can also induce the stress granules. And it seems to be, but that's well, a more general conclusion, that numerous pathways, not only nucleocytoplasmic transport, but also stress granule formation, are influenced by these arginine-containing DPRs.
Yeah. And the patients, are those actually, quote, liquid droplets, or these are?
Yeah, well, you should, well, what? Yeah, these are aggregates.
Those are aggregates.
Yeah. Yeah, the whole thing is, what we believe is that what we are looking now in culture is something that happens years before the formation of the aggregates. And that's actually what is also illustrated in this summarizing figure. That is that this process, so the phase separation, the formation of stress granules, but there are a lot of other structures in the cell that are formed in a similar way, that is a reversible process. And that then over years, this can become irreversible, that gels can be formed, and that after certain years, also these gels can form macroscopic aggregates. That's the idea. I mean, not so easy to prove that that's the same happens in patients because, well, what you see is the end result. You should, well, be able to go back years before the patient dies, which is a bit difficult.
And the aggregates in the patient, are they intracellular or extracellular?
Intracellular. No. Intracellular. Yeah, they're all intracellular. So cytoplasmic. Yeah.
I'm just confused with the liquid.
Yeah.
The aggregates are liquid?
No. The aggregates are not liquid. So the aggregates is, but that's the, so what you have, first you have soluble protein. Then you have the liquid-liquid phase separation, which gives you these droplets or these stress granules. Then that can lead to gels. That's the next step where there is maybe a core that is a bit more stable. And that can then over time generate these aggregates. So it's a stepwise process. And the first steps of the process are reversible. The last step, once you have an aggregate, it's not reversible anymore.
But when you do the experiment in mice, mm-hmm. you say ALS or the, in the models, you see right away aggregates. You don't see the liquid.
No, you don't see. No. Well.
So in human, if we look at the mice.
Yeah, but there is not a good mouse model for seen. Yeah, but there is one. There's a good one for ALS, but that's based on SOD1, on SOD1. Of which people think that that's the
CO of 98.
There is one good model, but it's not available to the community yet. So once that becomes available, we can test that.
They say they saw aggregates right away
in the patients.
No, in the mouse.
In the mouse.
The C9 also.
There are. Yeah, there is one model where they indeed see aggregates, but yeah.
Before seeing the liquid.
That's what you should check in this mouse model, but that has, as far as I know, not yet been done. Yeah, that's indeed an interesting experiment.
Can you tell me about the gel stuff?
Yeah.
The stage?
I hope.
Would you know about it?
Yeah, well, it's just, I mean, a less.
How do you distinguish it from the stress granule?
Yeah, well, in a test tube, you can see that it jellifies, that it's more, yeah.
In cells.
In cells, it's not possible to see that difference.
So in cells you see either
the stress granule. Yeah. The gel thing is more something that comes from a test tube experiment where they can indeed see. And mm-hmm. some people, well, that's a big debate in that field. They say that there is a stable core in these gel-like structures, which then is even another argument for saying there is already, yeah, it's an intermediate step to the formation of the aggregates. So that's, okay.
And it never happens in other tissues, only in motor neurons.
Maybe also in astrocytes, but that we don't know yet. That should be checked. So what is part of these stress granules?
Can I just say, no, stress granules happen
Yeah, stress granules happen everywhere. Yeah, but the formation of the aggregates, the transformation of these reversible structures to irreversible aggregates, that seems to be something unique for motor neurons.
Maybe because most cells are reproducible.
Yeah, of course.
Neurons are not so they're very. They live for many years.
For your entire life.
But muscle cells also don't reproduce.
Muscle cells regenerate.
Yeah, but motor neurons don't regenerate. So you're born with a number of motor neurons, and in the best case, you die with the same number. And ALS patients, they die when they have lost a large proportion of them. So that's so they live, well, if you're lucky, 90-100 years, which is makes them, all neurons do that.
Neurons, that depends. When you take the very long neurons, to the nerf sciatic, but the neurons, that's the big...
That's a big discussion, well, whether there is indeed... But for motor neurons, there is no regeneration. Also because it's very unlikely that even when you have a stem cell that is transformed into a motor neuron, will find its target. Because, I want to come back to that in a minute. I'm not sure whether I will get there. But the cell body of the motor neuron that is innervating your foot is just at the end of your back. So it's an axon of 1 meter in some people. Well, or less or more. Yeah. So it's
For the first signs are on the leg very often.
Yeah. So, you have two forms. But the most common form is where the legs and the arms are first involved in the disease. Okay, so this is, now what I want to come to axonal transport. So I think the introduction was already given. So what we have is iPSCs, so induced pluripotent stem cells that are generated from fibroblasts from ALS patients. So that a big difference is that these cells are from patients, are human, and they have the same mutations as the patient, and they have no overexpression. That's, I think, very important to mention. So you have the mutations in the same genetic context without any overexpression. And what is very interesting is that you can differentiate these cells into all kinds of cells, including motor neurons, and that's what you see here in this picture. So you can keep them, some people can keep them for 150 days. Well, we can keep them for 60, 70 days, and then they start to detach. So you can keep them for a very long time. They form very long axons. And what you can do in these cells is you can measure axonal transport. And this is a chymograph, what you see here. So these are cells, so this is the cell body, these are the neurites, and this cell is loaded with a dye that is going to the mitochondria, the functional mitochondria. And what you see here then is this is the length of a neurite, and so we have taken a picture every second. And so when we put all these pictures, all these lines next to each other, you get what they call a chymograph. And so a vertical line is a signal, a mitochondria that has not been moving. So all the lines that go from here to there or that go from there to there are moving mitochondria. And if you know, for instance, if this is the cell body and this is the end of the neurite, so then is this anterograde transport and this is retrograde transport. And so you can see this is the control, a control line. This is a line of a patient with a mutation that is causing ALS, but it could also have been a patient with a repeat. So these patients show exactly the same. Over time in culture, they don't die, by the way. That's one of our major frustrations. We can keep these cells for months and they don't die. But what they start to show is a defect in axonal transport. In this case of mitochondria, and so this is what I just explained, it's over time. So at week 2...
Transport of mitochondria, I mean, they're being transported by mitochondria.
Yeah, mitochondria are transported along the axons. Very important because you need energy, for instance, at the neuromuscular junction.
So the one mitochondria,
they're multiple.
Yeah. So you can see that there are a lot of stationary mitochondria as well. So there are mitochondria that don't move, so that stay always at the same place. But the majority of mitochondria are moving in both directions. So it's not so clear why, but anyway. So they're
motors.
Sorry?
I mean, they're motors for both directions.
Yeah. There are motors for both directions, and that's what they do, especially in controls. So here you can see that it is developing over time. So the after week two of differentiation, the transport is still okay. After 3 weeks, it's lower, and then it's going down. And if we waited longer, it would even go more. It will even become lower. It's not only mitochondria, by the way. We have been looking at other cargos. This is just an example of ER vesicles, but it could have been lysosomes. It could have been RNA, which we can also visualize. It all shows the same phenotype. Over time, you get less axonal transport.
Did you investigate the synapse, if it's no. The same granule formation or not, vesicle formation or not, because that implies the whole.
Yeah, but these cells don't form, normally they should form a neuromuscular junction because these are lower motor neurons, so they don't form, and that's also what we see, they don't really form synapses. They are looking around for muscles, I suppose. And I will show you a picture where we have indeed combined motor neurons with muscles. That's what we are doing now. So we are trying to make motor neurons, muscles in a culture dish.
Do they have the arginine-containing peptide?
Yes, not the ones I just showed you, but we have also iPSCs from patients with repeats, of which we have shown that they contain DPRs, also in the medium, by the way, and they also show the same axonal transport defect. Seems to be a general. And just to show you how movies look, okay, it's running. So this is a culture. It's a fuss patient, but it could have been a C9 patient as well. So this is the cell body, and if you look very good, you can see some movement here. So this is a situation where you don't have much transport anymore. The controls, they look like this, but I will tell you immediately what this is. So I hope you can see that there is much more transport now, so you can. You can see here, for instance, this is a very nice one. It starts again. You can see it comes from here and it's going all the way.
Why do you have the HDAC inhibitor?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to tell you now. We can rescue this by incubating these cultures overnight with an HDAC6 inhibitor. And it's a misnomer, so it's doing everything except deacetylating histones. So they have classified it as a histone deacetylase, but it is deacetylating cytoplasmic substrates. And one of the substrates are the microtubules. And I will show it in a minute. So the difference between this and this is just an overnight treatment with an HDAC6 inhibitor. By the way, we have other systems and other diseases where we also see axonal transport defects. If I ever see a situation where there is less axonal transport, I always tell my people, add an HDAC6 inhibitor, and then you get surprising results. I mean, it always rescues. And this is, by the way, also how it looks in a control. So this is the situation. This is the patient. This is control, whatever the mutation.
What is suppressing it?
The HDAC6 inhibitor, what is this doing? I will first show the cartoon. So what you have is, to get normal transport, you need to have tracks, you need to have the microtubules, and they need to be acetylated. If they are acetylated, the motor proteins are well connected to these microtubules. If for one reason or another the microtubules get deacetylated and the protein, the enzyme that is doing that is HDAC6, histone deacetylase 6, but it should be called tubulin deacetylase instead. So then you get a situation like this, and then there is less axonal transport because the motor proteins detach. And so by taking these HDAC6 inhibitors, we reverse this situation into that situation. And then I go one slide back to prove that it is indeed true. So this is acetylated tubulin in patients. This is a patient. So this is the patient. This is, by the way, the isogenic control. So with CRISPR-Cas9, we have corrected the mutation. That's also an advantage of these iPSCs. You can just have the same line, same genetic background, and just one mutation corrected. And then these are treated overnight with two different HDAC6 inhibitors, and you can see that the intensity of the acetylated tubulin is dramatically increased. And by the way, you can also see that there is a slight decrease in the muted in comparison to the isogenic control, and that's also something we see in a lot of situations, that the acetylation of tubulin is going down in disease condition.
But you can use it in for patients?
That's a good question. We are negotiating to start clinical trials, not in ALS, because that's still, we are not able to cure ALS, but we are also using the same strategies in peripheral neuropathies. And just to give you one illustration of which peripheral neuropathies we are thinking about, so you have chemotherapy-induced neuropathies. And there you can, similar things as here. Axonal transport is going less well, and also acetylation of tubulin is going down. So there you could say, okay, we give vincristine, for instance, together with an HDAC6 inhibitor to a patient in order to prevent the neuropathy from happening. Okay, it seems that I have to speed up a little bit, but I'm almost there. I just wanted to show you this conclusion, but where I also show what you see here is a two-compartment system. So here are the motor neurons cultured in one side of the dish. Then you have mini grooves, and what you see here are the axons that are crossing that groove, and they make contact with what you see here in pink. These are muscle cells. And so this is very recent, so we are now also trying to measure axonal transport in this system, and we are also trying to figure out whether we have or whether we can get neuromuscular junctions. And I think the conclusions, I've already stated them. And just to make sure that you understand what we are talking about, so these are very long axons of up to 1 meter. The motor neurons are in your spinal cord, and then the muscles that you have are in your arms or in your legs. And this is the problem that we hope to solve by using HDAC6 inhibitors. Just to wrap up, the nucleocytoplasmic transport defect could be responsible for the mislocalization. This is a two-hit model, like it is proposed in literature. I'm not sure whether it's completely true. The second hit could be an aberrant liquid-liquid phase separation, and then this could lead to a number of things, including, for instance, also axonal transport defects. I also want to say something about whole genome sequencing. I will be very short because that was actually what was asked. So apart from the four mutations that I've been focusing on today, there are many more genetic causes already known for the disease. And the most recent ones, because this is a function of the time, the most recent ones are the result of exome and whole genome sequencing. And that is, for the moment, a project going on in the ALS field where patients, and that's why they call it Project MIND, patients are giving their DNA, and then, we have to give money, or the public has to give money. You can buy the sequencing of one chromosome, or you can buy a half a DNA profile of a patient. And so they want to go up to 15,000 ALS patients and 7,500 controls. And just one example that it works, there will be, because this is a slide under embargo, there will be this will be the cover of Neuron in 2 weeks, where they have found mutations in KIF5A, as a kinesin protein, so which is a motor protein, which is mutated. And what is, illustrated, so here you have the axon shipping company that is transporting all these containers along the microtubules. And so apparently when you have a mutation, it doesn't work that well. I mean, it's a visual way. It's made by geneticists, by the way, but I like it. So I think it's a nice, and here has to come neurons, so it's not yet finished. Okay, I'm almost done. If you give me, can I have 3 more minutes? Yeah. 3 more minutes just to wrap up everything what is known in the field.
But you have so many kids, so many motors. So
yes, not all are mutated.
All of them are affected.
Yeah, no. Yeah, that we don't know.
Because you say every protein you look at didn't go. The transport of everything, nothing went through.
Yeah, that's true.
It means all the motors are affected.
Yeah, but we don't know how. In some cases it will be genetics. Yeah. In other cases we don't know. I would like to end with a movie of 3 minutes, so it's not, it will not last more than 3 minutes. Nature Neuroscience Review asked us to summarize 20 years of research in ALS. It was not easy, but I like the end result and I want to share it with you.
Amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, shortened to ALS, is a neurodegenerative disease which usually begins in adulthood and advances rapidly. It's characterized by the deterioration and loss of both upper and lower motor neurons. As the motor neurons stop sending signals, the muscles weaken, leading to paralysis. When the muscles in the diaphragm are paralyzed, this can be fatal. There is no known cure for ALS. For most people, the cause of their ALS is unknown, but some people inherit the disease from their parents. By studying the genes that are altered in these patients, scientists have pinpointed processes in the neurons that might be causing ALS. It's too early to know which of these altered processes are a result of the disease and which could be a cause, but it's clear that they affect many different aspects of the motor neuron function. Let's start in the cell body. Here, proteins that are not transported into the nucleus build up in the cytoplasm. Errors in the systems that build up and break down proteins also cause other misfolded proteins to accumulate. The different proteins can then aggregate and can become toxic to cells in several ways. For example, they can damage mitochondria, the cell's power generators. Mitochondrial damage can lead to oxidative stress, which can trigger breaks in the DNA of the cell. ALS seems to affect DNA repair processes as well. When DNA breaks are poorly repaired, it ultimately contributes to the death of the neuron. The cell's transport machinery can also be damaged. For example, ALS-affected neurons often have problems transporting RNA, proteins, and vesicles, both in the cytoplasm and along the neuron's axon. These vesicles contain important cell signaling molecules called neurotransmitters. If these can't be moved along the axon or released, the neuron can't send messages to its target cells. Damage to the cytoskeleton can also cause the axon to retract. If this happens, the axon can no longer connect to the muscle nearby and can no longer signal the muscle to contract. Other cell types can also be involved in ALS. Oligodendrocytes, which electrically insulate the axon and provide support to the motor neuron, don't work in people with ALS. Reduced uptake of neurotransmitters by astrocytes can lead to overactivation of the receptors at the synapse and death of the neuron. Finally, astrocytes and microglia can produce factors that protect or damage motor neurons. Neuronal death occurs when excessive damaging factors are produced. Further research is needed to find out which of these many processes cause the motor neuron degeneration seen in ALS patients. Targeting new drug therapies at those processes might lead to a treatment for this incurable disease.
That's it.
Perhaps not surprising question from me. Why do you, you're looking for money to sequence subjects affected and controls, but why do you need to resequence controls?
I think they also rely on public databases, but they want to, they want to increase the number. I think that's also why they focus much more on patients than on control. And there are
indeed.
I have a question. Do you know where the peptide containing arginine are located in the cells?
In the cytoplasm.
Not in the ER?
Could be. No, because ER stress is something that... I don't exclude
so
it.
So they may cause ER stress.
The paper, that's the point that the paper that was published the day before yesterday in Nature Genetics want to make.
I read the paper.
Yeah, you should. It's interesting. I mean, I had to write a commentary yesterday evening, so I know everything about it.
Maybe you said it. I missed it. How is the transcription of the repeats? Is it, that's a polycystronic, a very long messenger which you should maybe detect, or is it cleaved right away, and then the translation, how is that?
Yeah, it's not known.
No, okay.
Yeah,
no, I think it's a full messenger.
Is it? Yeah, but, well, but it's some. There are also people that say that it stops in the middle of the repeat. Yeah, that the transcription process. Well, that you have also messengers that are could be.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you won't get the translated.
Yeah, but not all these.
You cannot have pieces of mRNA and get translation, right? Messenger RNAs of this.
Group. Yeah, but I mean these RNAs are not polyadenylated, are also not capped. They are not. So they are excised from the introns. They are introns.
Translated as part of the mRNA starting from the middle. That's the whole idea, that it doesn't...
Yeah, I'm not so sure about that.
From the beginning, it starts from the middle, and that's why it was so controversial at the beginning, because there was no any precedent.
But it also happens in the reverse way, in the antisense.
Also, when you do a reverse, so you have also a mRNA that is translated, you have a transcript.
Yeah,
right. Indeed. Coming from the other side.
But that's not polyadenylated.
It has also polyadenylated.
It isn't.
He's the expert on mRNA.
Then I should sit together next to him this evening. Yeah, I can learn more from you than yeah. But
if it's not polyadenylated, it won't go out of the nucleus. It will get stuck in the.
Okay, that's good. Good to know. Yeah.
So this is completely multifactorial.
Yeah, that's what we think. So everybody is right. Huh? Everybody is right in the field.
Everybody is right in the field, right?
That's the problem, yeah.
But maybe that's good.
That's so how you keep friends, yeah.
Okay, if we go now to trying to deal with patient situation, right? So first, yeah. Where do you think one should, at the end of the day?
That's a very good question. Well, the field at this moment is focusing, especially for the genetic forms, on antisense oligos. So because it's gain of function, in that's at least what we think it is, for SOT1, TDP, FUS, and C9ORF. So if you can prevent the mutant form from being formed, so if you can prevent the translation of the mutant containing transcript, then you don't have the mutant protein, and that should, well, help. So antisense oligos is the thing people are investing a lot of money in for the moment. Right. But that's only helpful for a limited number of patients.
Yeah, but let's go through the antisense, right?
Yeah.
I would have to do this, the whole life of the individual?
These antisense oligos are relatively stable, but...
No, I understand that.
But you have to re-inject intrathecally, regularly.
Yeah, you're not going to do that.
Well, it depends what kind of disease. In SMA, for instance, in spinal muscular atrophy, the therapy that is there is also injection of antisense oligos?
No, I realize this, right? But
yeah, it's very expensive, first of all. And it's indeed an intrathecal injection.
Exactly.
It's not, it's not something you're looking for.
You would like to find a way to maybe cross the blood-brain barrier or...
Yeah, indeed. Or, well, the easiest way to stop people from getting familial ALS is prenatal screening.
Yeah.
That's the most obvious thing to do, and that happens already.
Really?
Of
I mean,
course.
Is it 100% penetrance?
Yeah.
Close to. Not 100%, but it's close to 100%.
So it justifies prenatal?
Mm. Wow. Yeah, and it's a terrible disease as well. So if you can, it's the same with, peripheral neuropathies, the inherited ones. Also there you have prenatal screening already as a routine kind of thing. Although you don't die from these diseases, so that's... It's more an ethical thing than anything else, but it happens. I mean, pretty sure that it happens.
God, so if we eliminated Hawkins, he would not go through this screen. What does he think about it?
Sorry?
This famous ALS patient, actually two of them,
one. Well, he's not genetic.
He's not genetic, so for him it doesn't help.
Ah.
So for him it only helps for 10% maximally for 10% of patients. 90%. Yeah, are not helped. So we have to continue doing research, even if we can solve all the genetic forms. Yeah, and so for the other forms, we hope that we can find a pathway, like for instance axonal transport, That is a common mechanism also seen in sporadic ALS patients, that we can symptomatically treat these patients and that it could help them to survive longer.
Sure, but for example, you describe the acetylation of tubulin, but then you also have a kinase
effect. Have to run, have to save everybody.
Yeah. But it's a, well, you don't have to convince me that it's a complex disease. Yeah. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you for funding this.
Thank you.
You're speaking about detailed therapy, but what do you think about therapy, right, pluripotent or totipotent stem cells? Is that not...
Well, the problem there is...
Right, because I think for brain, for Parkinson and several other...
Yeah, but the problem is that you have to restore... So you have to restore functionality. Yeah. So if you replace, well, for instance, this motor neuron is dying. So the axon. So yeah. First of all, what we think is happening that the first problems happen here. So you get denervation, then you get axon retraction, and in the end, the motor neurons die. So what are you gonna do? You're gonna transplant stem cells here, and how will they find their targets 1 meter further away?
That's their job. They should find, because in heart, if I.
Yeah, but what's it's a distance.
Well, informed, it's the way they inject and then the cells.
Yeah, but what distance do they have to cross? I think it's. I mean, this is one.
Has it been tried?
This is 1 meter. Yeah, well, stem cell, yeah, it has been tried in China. So I mean, and not in the best possible way, I suppose. But anyway, there was at a certain moment, it was a big hype in the ALS field. So people thought that they, and not for the simple reason to replace the motor neurons, but to replace the environment, the toxic environment. Because, well, astrocytes and microglia also seem to play a role. So if you can replace the astrocytes, maybe then you will have a benefit. In the end, everything that they have tried failed. So it didn't have much. I'm not excluding that it will help, but for the moment, it's not the way people are, well, going forward, let's state it that way.
Because that's a radical therapy.
Yeah, but here, I mean, an axon, well, we are so happy that we can bridge in the culture, we can bridge maybe, well, it's a few hundred micrometers, 800 micrometers it is, I think, and that is already a challenge. So how can you get it 1 meter? I mean, hopefully, well, yeah. Hopefully, I wouldn't, yeah.
You know, other neuron, mRNA translation is mostly concentrated at the synapse, right? So the question here, I don't know about motor neuron.
Yeah.
So again,
yes, indeed. Yes.
They need to travel
a long time. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. No, there is clearly translation. There is clearly translation here at the synapse for the simple reason, if something has to be made here, and the message has always to come from the nucleus, that will take too much time. So if there is something needed here to react very fast to whatever situation, local translation is the only way to do that. And there is RNA there, so that's and there is RNA transport as well.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you very much.